wonderful people. I'm so happy to be here. I'd like you to help me this evening by please standing and joining hands. The wonderful word that we have in our language is the word Natsamat. Natsamat means that we're one. Natsamat Shqualawin. Do you want to join hands? Oh, okay. And I don't even have my glasses on. The great word is Natsamat. The other great word is Shqualawin. Shqualawin means heart and mind. Natsamat Shqualawin, we're one heart and we're one mind. More and more as I move through time and I get to be with people like yourselves, good people, solid people, strong people, I become more and more aware that we need to connect. We need to connect with each other. It's that strong connection with each other that keeps the positive energy moving forward. Siam, Haichka, Haichka, Ha Ha, Musquium Tummo, Ha Ha, Musquium Tummo, Haitsapka Siam. Thank you, wonderful and strong people. I'm welcoming you here this evening on behalf of all of the children from Musquium, their parents, grandparents, and their elected leadership. Please, please, they're inviting you to open your hearts and open your minds to the words that you're going to hear in this great house tonight. Haitsapka siam, haitska, haitska, haitska.
Please welcome SFU President Andrew Petter.
Thank you, Shane, for that wonderful welcome. As we mark Canada's 150th year, it's important we acknowledge the much longer history and contributions of Canada's First Peoples. And with that, I want to, of course, acknowledge that we are privileged to gather on the traditional territory of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh First Nations. As president of SFU, I want to add my own enthusiastic welcome to this fifth SFU Public Square Community Summit. This event has its origins in the strategic vision that Simon Fraser University set for itself 5 years ago, a vision that committed us to be Canada's most community-engaged research university. Within that commitment, we resolved that SFU should serve as a forum for public dialogue, believing that the health of communities, local and global, depends upon citizens coming together to share information, to exchange views, and to seek common ground. The result was SFU Public Square, which operates year-round and once a year invites the public to participate in a community summit on a question of public importance. In this, Canada's 150th anniversary year, it seemed timely to consider this country's place in the world and to pose the question, who needs Canada? Given world events, it's a question that has become even more pressing. In a post-Brexit, post-Trump world in which nationalism, protectionism, and nativism are on the rise, what role is there for a middle power with an open economy that has defined itself by its commitments to humanitarianism, freer trade, and multiculturalism? At a time when labor markets are being disrupted by technology and globalization, in which ethnic and religious tensions are on the rise, and in which we face the existential threat of climate change, how can Canada best position itself to influence world events while at the same time protecting its interests and preserving our values? These questions are important for all of us. The answers that we provide are key to our country's character and to our nation's future, both in our domestic and in our international dealings. We at SFU believe that universities have a particularly important stake in this dialogue. Universities have obligations not just to educate students and generate knowledge, but also to support human rights and to advance democratic values. Universities have responsibilities to foster intercultural understanding, to encourage international dialogue, and to promote scientific knowledge and evidence-based decision-making. This summit is one way in which we at SFU are demonstrating our commitment to these obligations and responsibilities, and showing how an engaged university can serve as an agent for community dialogue and deliberation. To assist in this endeavor, we have convened an outstanding panel, uniquely well qualified to offer informed, thoughtful, and constructive answers. But before going to the panel, let me say how grateful we are for the strong partnerships that SFU enjoys every day, and especially on occasions such as our Public Square Community Summit. To bring greetings from one of our most important and constant partners, please join me in welcoming from the City of Vancouver, Deputy Mayor Jeff Meggs.
Well, thank you, Andrew, and good evening, everyone, and thanks to Shane Point for that great introduction. Like the University, the City of Vancouver is proud of its relationship, and we're trying to build a relationship with the First Nations on whose unceded territory the city stands, and that reconciliation process is part of the community building and the work that we think is continuing tonight. You know, when I heard the theme, who needs Canada, I couldn't really get it out of my head. It's probably a question that First Nations leaders have been asking for hundreds of years. When I graduated from university, I got to go on one of the first youth exchanges from Canada World Youth, and I led a pretty sheltered life. And we had a big gathering with people from all over the world, various countries, and they invited us to sing our national song. And I had no idea what Canada's national song was. I wasn't going to sing God Save the Queen or O Canada. It just wasn't fitting with what other people were doing. I had a chance to show my national dress. No idea. Our national food. I was feeling pretty low by that time. But over the years, I've concluded that really that should become an advantage for us in Canada, because it allows us to see diversity and to see opportunity that maybe is not as easily seen from other places. And maybe the question we should be asking is not who needs Canada, but what does the rest of the world need, and answer that we can do that, and we'd like to try. That's the attitude that we're trying to take at the City of Vancouver on a number of fronts, working with the community and partners like Simon Fraser and Coastal Health and our First Nations and many others, to have a healthy city strategy, to have an engaged city where people participate in the political process. We have a Vancouver Immigration Partnership, which seeks to support all the organizations that are welcoming newcomers. And of course, we call ourselves, hopefully, and I think we can deliver on it with time and work, a city of reconciliation. So the common threads through all these projects is the belief in partnerships and collaboration, commitment to diversity, and a common vision we all share about the communities we live in now and we aspire to in the future. And so it's with great pleasure that I bring greetings on behalf of Mayor Gregor Robertson and our entire council. I thank the Simon Fraser University organizers for putting this event together, and I wish you a very interesting evening.
Thank you very much, Jeff. And events like this do take a lot of support and a lot of partnerships. So I encourage you to look at your program and take note of the many partners who've helped to support us in tonight's event and the other events that form part of this year's Community Summit. And now to our panel, or more correctly, to the person who will introduce our panelists and moderate this evening's discussion, Laura Lynch. Loyal CBC listeners will know that Laura has covered Canada and the world for more than 20 years. She's been a correspondent in London and Washington. She's covered everything from the attacks of September 11th and the subsequent conflicts in Afghanistan to more recent upheavals in Syria and Iran. More recently, she's been a regular guest host on The Current, As It Happens, and The Sunday Edition. Among other achievements, Laura has held a Nieman Fellowship at Harvard University and won awards from the British Bar Association, Amnesty International, the Overseas Press Club in New York, and the Gabrielle Awards. Speaking from a personal perspective, I can also report that she was a student of mine at the University of Victoria, and back then she was one of the most engaged students I have ever encountered, and she continues to be one of the most engaged commentators within Canada. So please join me in welcoming Laura Lynch.
So I'm going to be running the show tonight. That's something I like the sound of. And I welcome all of you here and to people who are watching on the webcast. It gives me no endless pleasure to believe that there are so many people who are interested in what is going on both in Canada and around the world, subjects that are near and dear to my heart. And I think that what we're talking about tonight is of such great importance given everything that's going on in the world. I just want to give you a sense of how things are going to unfold this evening. And just in case you haven't already been told, I would ask you to turn the ringers off your phones, but keep the phone on because there'll be need for it, and I'll explain that in just a second. So as Andrew said, we do have a great panel tonight. I'll be introducing each one of them, and then each one of them will be coming up in turn to present sort of an opening statement for about 5 minutes each on the subject of Who Needs Canada. Then I'll be leading a discussion between them for a little while after that. And then, and I have to read this because I have never heard of this before, we are going to be using some new technology. And I'm told it's user-friendly. It is called Slido. If you can submit your questions, if you have questions for the panel, at www.slido.com. on your mobile device. And for those of you who are watching on the webcast, click on the Slido link that is listed below the webcast. And then when you get to the website, you enter the event code, which is Who Needs Canada, all one word. And once you do that, you'll be able to submit your questions online, and you'll be able to see other questions that people in the audience have submitted. And then, this is kind of cool, you get to vote for the questions that you most want answered. And there's a team backstage that's going to be monitoring all of this. And toward the end of the night, I'll be getting a list of those questions and we'll be posing them to the people on the panel. The other thing I just want to mention is if you are in love with Twitter, we do have a hashtag for the evening that will allow you to tweet out about what a fascinating evening this is. Just hang on 1 second. It is hashtag Who Needs Canada? No surprise there. And the other thing I want to let you know is after we are done with our event here on stage, we're going to continue with dialogue circles. We're going to have a conversation with you involved. You actually get to do some work tonight. Nobody told you that. There's going to be three dialogue circles in the lobby of about 30 minutes, and there's limited room at each of the circles, first come, first serve. We want you to have your voice heard on the topics we're discussing tonight. They'll be themed differently, hosted by different thinkers in the field, and I'll let you know what they are so you can think about them as we go on. The first will look at Canada's opportunities for leadership when it comes to the environment and climate change. And the second will focus on international relations and security. And then the third one will be talking about international development and human rights. And when I repeat this at the end of the program, I'll let you know who is leading each one of these. All right, time to welcome our panelists. Now, it's my notes here. Shuvaloy Majumdar is a Monk Senior Fellow with the Macdonald Laurier Institute and is a writer at the Huffington Post. From 2011 to 2015, he served as the policy director to successive Canadian foreign ministers. He was also senior policy advisor to its Minister for International Development, focusing on international security and the global economy. Before that, he was based in Iraq and Afghanistan from 2006 to 2010. We were trying to figure out whether we crossed paths at some point in there. That's where he led the International Republican Institute, which is a Washington-based nonpartisan organization chaired by U.S. Senator John McCain. Shuvaloy was a visiting foreign policy scholar at the University of British Columbia's Lowe Institute for Global Studies from 2010 to 2012. He is currently based in Ottawa and Washington, D.C. Please welcome Shuvaloy Majumdar. Roland Paris is a university research chair in international security and governance at the University of Ottawa, where he teaches in the Graduate School of Public and International Affairs. He was recently Prime Minister Justin Trudeau's senior advisor on global affairs and defense. He's also held several advisory positions in the Canadian government, including the Privy Council Office, the Department of Foreign Affairs, and I'm just going to tell you now, I'm not 100% healthy. So forgive me, I'm doing my best here. I'm doing better than I was 2 weeks ago when I had no voice. The Department of Foreign Affairs and the Federal Provincial Relations Office. He's been the Director of Research for the Conference Board of Canada, Assistant Professor of International Affairs at the University of Colorado at Boulder, and Visiting Researcher at Sciences Po in Paris, and the John Hopkins School of Advanced International Studies in Washington, D.C. Welcome, Roland Paris. I'm going to get some water. This seems like a very good idea. Okay. Now, next we have Senator Yuen Pao Wu was appointed to the upper chamber in November of 2016 and sits as an independent senator representing British Columbia. Prior to joining the Senate, he was president of HQ Vancouver, which is a public-private partnership that promotes British Columbia as a location for head offices of international companies. From 2005 to 2014, he was president and CEO of the Asia-Pacific Foundation of Canada, where he continues to serve as Distinguished East Asia Fellow. From 2002 to 2012, he was Canada's representative on the Pacific Economic Cooperation Council. Senator Wu has previously worked for the Institute of Southeast Asian Studies, the Monetary Authority of Singapore, and the Government of Singapore Investment Corporation. He's been an advisor and consultant to the Asian Development Bank, the World Bank, APEC, and the OECD. Please welcome Senator Wu. All right, one more. One more. It's their problem. They have such long resumes. In 2007, Sheila Watt-Cloutier was nominated for the Nobel Peace Prize for her advocacy work in showing the impact of global climate change on human rights, especially in the Arctic. From 1995 to 2002, she was elected the Canadian president of the Inuit Circumpolar Council. She was later elected in 2002 to become the international chair of the ICC, representing the 155,000 Inuit from Canada, Greenland, Alaska, and Russia, and she held this post until 2006. Ms. Watt-Cloutier is an officer of the Order of Canada, the recipient of the Aboriginal Achievement Award, the UN Champion of the Earth Award, the Norwegian Sophie Prize, and the Right Livelihood Award, which she won in November of 2015, which is widely considered the Nobel alternative. Watt-Cloutier is the author of the memoir, The Right to Be Cold, One Woman's Story of Protecting Her Culture, the Arctic, and the Whole Planet, published in 2015. Please welcome Sheila Watt-Cloutier. All right. Everybody settled?
Pretty much.
Because you're going to have to get up, because Shuvaloy Majumdar is going to be our, I believe, our first person speaking.
Exactly right.
Yep.
Well, good evening, everybody. I want to thank the organizers for putting together this community summit in a world that is networked even more so than it ever has been before. We tend to exist in our own echo chambers. So it's a real pleasure to be part of this forum. The summit is a welcome exception to enable a real dialogue, which I hope I'll be able to afford you over the course of the next 5 minutes as a starting point. It's a big question, who needs Canada? Canada is one of the greatest nations in the world. Others look to us for leadership. Canadians have always been willing to make sacrifices in order to do the right thing, and that our universal values of freedom, democracy, human rights, and the rule of law are not just the domain of any one political persuasion, but our wish for our country and indeed for the world. So to answer the question of who needs Canada, we must accept that the world is indeed changing, and changing at blinding speed. And we must be sure that when we go into the world, we act on these convictions and values, we actually understand the world as it is, rather than what we wish it were. Too often, we fail to do such thoughtful analysis, and we surrender our potential influence as our do-gooder, Boy Scouting attitude who mistake moral finger-wagging for meaningful action. Three orthodoxies come to mind, which I'm here to challenge a little bit. The first is the orthodoxy or the idea of tabling a resolution on Syria at the United Nations General Assembly as meaningful action against an ongoing violent war and genocide in Syria. The second is pursuing deals with other countries around the world on the basis of a chair in New York at the United Nations, rather than pursuing deals in, around the idea of shared prosperity and peace on a bilateral basis with countries around the world. The third is the idea of peacekeeping itself, perhaps in missions where our interests are not readily identifiable versus making meaningful investments in the security architecture and investments of future threats. So let's talk about the threats of the future. Today, across the world, there is an authoritarian resurgency in the form of predatory states and transatlantic populism. Predatory states like Iran, Russia, China, increasingly Turkey, and Venezuela are growing more belligerent, not more restrained. Europopulism across the transatlantic face, whether it's in the United States or in Europe properly, is affecting a global demography that has been overlooked through some of the prosperity that has been experienced in the world, often caused by automation and sometimes by migration. It has accompanied a democratic contraction around the world, in which established democracies are under foreign assault and emerging ones are increasingly vulnerable. Today, the European economy is shrinking in its growth, not expanding, while Asia's and Africa's is, quite frankly, booming. Canadian leadership is needed in Europe to counter Russia's hybrid war in Ukraine and its cyber warfare and information operations across the continent. Canadian leadership is needed in the Indo-Pacific as a hedge against China's rise. There are bold opportunities for Canadian leadership, for innovation with India, Japan, South Korea, countries in Southeast Asia, and inside China within Hong Kong and Taiwan, which must be seized rather than just a sole pivot towards Beijing. And in the Pacific, Canada must build on the gains that it has earned over the last half century by deploying a security contribution commensurate to what Canada's traditional alliances have had in the Atlantic. Canadian leadership is needed in the Middle East and in Africa, especially by the persecuted, most vulnerable religious, ethnic, and sexual minorities. Canadian leadership is needed in deeper partnerships with centers in the region committed to pluralism and prosperity, like the United Arab Emirates, the Kingdom of Jordan, and the Kurdistan region. It is needed by in the Middle East, particularly by the only democracy of the region, Israel, particularly in multilateral fora, where it is singled out and where, in the world more globally, anti-Semitism is on the rise. Canadian leadership is needed by the world's poorest through development innovation. Why can we not challenge Canadian technology to work with other emerging economies to solve some of the biggest problems in the world today? In the last 150 years, Canada has grown into the model of a pluralist society, an example for the world. Yet Canada's economy is 70% concentrated on trade with the United States today. This will need to shift in this increasing globalized world, especially with the shift in a focus to Asia. And so Canada must transition from a model pluralist democracy to actually leading as a model pluralist democracy. This has started in recent times. I suppose in the last year, Canada has even transitioned from going from Canada is back to the post-Trump world of being Canada is somewhat silent. It's about how we as a country, all of us, from across the political spectrum, step up our leadership for those who need Canada to lead. Thank you.
All right, you issued quite a challenge there. We'll probably challenge you to provide some more details of all those ideas when coming up. Next, we have Roland Paris.
Yeah, I'm also looking forward to hearing the details there, Shu. But listen, thank you so much for having me and to SFU for this program that you have. It's really wonderful. As somebody who has spent my life as a career as an academic and from time to time dipped into government service, it's just so critical that our universities provide the kind of platforms for broader discussions of current policy issues and reflective discussions, not just the quick hits on Twitter, which has come to kind of dominate not just our politics, but the politics of some of our nearest and dearest friends. My quick answer to the question, who needs Canada, is frankly, at this moment, that everybody does. Now, there is a tendency, I think, for us as Canadians to exaggerate our influence in the world. But this is a special moment. And Canada is a model of pluralist, open, welcoming country, society, is something that is being recognized and something that we need to cherish, not to be haughty about, but to recognize what we have created here over decades, over centuries, imperfect as it is, and with so much work left to do, including in our relations with First Nations people, but nevertheless pretty remarkable. And a place where not only people from different countries and different traditions and different religions can live together peacefully, but a place where the rule of law and institutions are the basis for us to work out our differences. And this is bread and the bone, but we are not immune from the kinds of pressures that we've seen growing elsewhere. We've seen it from time to time in our own politics. We see it now in some aspects of our politics. I don't want to get in a partisan fight with Shuv here, but some aspects of our politics. We have to be extremely vigilant about this because what we treasure is not written in nature. It can go away. And we need to keep reaffirming the importance of these values to ourselves. And it needs to inform our foreign policy as well. But we are also living in a much more complex time. And we have to be able to manage expertly our foreign policy. And it's going to take a tremendous amount of effort and attention. Managing relations with the United States for the next 4 years is truly going to be a challenge. We have extraordinary interests at stake in our relations with the United States. 75% of our manufacturing exports, 20% of our GDP, and it's not just the trade, it's the fact that our economies are already largely integrated. Maintaining secure and reliable access to the U.S. market is as close to a vital national interest in our foreign policy as we have, and keeping the border reliably open. But we have now a president, and it's a pleasure for me not to be in government so I can speak quite openly about this, who is a chaos machine. And it's not just due to disorganization or inexperience in government, although that's part of it. It's because that's how he has run his affairs. There is a strategic benefit to keeping his adversaries and partners alike off balance, preserving his freedom of maneuver, and keeping people guessing. And I think that that is going to be a challenge not just for Canada, but for every country going forward. And balancing our interests and our values and relations with the United States is going to be tough. We are 38 days into it. There are 1,423 days left in President Trump's first term. And the discussions of NAFTA haven't even started yet. The U.S. Secretary of Commerce, Wilbur Ross, was just confirmed by the U.S. Senate a few hours ago. So a lot of work still to come. But that kind of complexity will also be a defining feature of many other aspects of our foreign policy. Shuv mentioned China. Part of our long-term interests are to expand our trade relations with the fastest-growing large economies in the world, to deal with countries that are emerging as global actors, to deal with the complexity of interacting with countries with whom we have, in some areas, profound disagreements, and in other areas, interests which we can pursue together. We can work with China on climate change. China is even interested and is now a major contributor to UN peace operations. And of course, we have mutual economic interests with China. How are we going to manage that? It's going to be complicated, but we can't look at that complexity and just say we're going to sit on the sidelines. We can walk and chew gum at the same time, just as we will have to manage our relations with our closest partner and ally, the United States. One last example of this complexity, I'm probably past 5 minutes already, which
thank
is...
You. You're lucky I don't have a stopwatch.
Oh, thank God for that. Nobody look at your watch. Is Russia. Not a rising power like China, a declining power, which is doing everything that it can to divide the West, to disrupt our domestic politics, the politics of liberal democratic countries, to undermine faith in democratic institutions, to weaken the U.S. and the U.S. reputation in particular, and to carve out its own sphere of influence. But guess what? We also need to work with Russia on the Arctic. And the truth is that Russia has been a pretty constructive partner in the Arctic space for a long time. It is not in our interest to militarize the relationship in the Arctic. There are other areas where we also have interests in working with Russia, including on measures to avoid unwanted, unexpected escalations in the military standoff which currently exists in Europe. Oh yes, we should be firm and stand with our NATO partners, but let us also recognize that there are risks associated with all of the close encounters of ships and planes and close deployment of troops. We need to talk to the Russians about minimizing those risks. So, Shuv said we have to deal with the world as it is, not as we would wish it to be. The world as it is complicated. And that's one of the reasons why it's so important for there to be discussions like this one tonight, and for universities to be investing in creating space for these kinds of discussions. Because the more that Canadians have an opportunity to think about the
push and pull pressures facing us and how important our foreign policy is and getting it right, the more likely we will get it right. Thank you.
All right, thank you for that comment. And now, the new senator comes to the stage. Not your maiden senatorial speech, though.
Thank you, Laura, for not putting any more pressure on me to deliver on this speech. Let me start by thanking SFU Public Square for, first of all, for continuing this annual tradition of the community summit, but in particular for choosing this topic, as both my previous panelists have said, very timely and very much needed in this country and around the world. You know, when I was first presented with the question, who needs Canada, I thought to myself, there are at least two ways to look at it. You could read who needs Canada as, who needs Canada anyway? That's, of course, the cynical view, and this is not a view that I subscribe to, and I'm sure it's not the view that the organizers intended, and not the view that we would be pursuing in this panel discussion. But there's the other extreme interpretation of who needs Canada, and it goes something along the lines of, thank God for Canada. Put up your hand, who needs Canada? We're here. We're here to help you out. We're here to rescue you. I'm not sure why you're clapping, but I meant that a little bit satirically. I think that's wrong as well. I think that is a view of Canada that presumes that we have a certain corner on virtue, on goodness, on prudence, on the right way to do things, governance and rule of law, that we have perhaps some kind of obligation or mission to export or transfer to the world. Some of that is true, but I think that extreme view is also unhealthy, which is why I'm going to do the classic thing that panelists do when they ask a question. I'm not going to answer the question, who needs Canada? And I'm actually going to reframe the question into one which is along these lines, and that is to ask, what does Canada need to understand its place in the world? And you will see behind me on the screen, by the way, full disclosure, the organizers asked me to come up with an image. That's why I came up with an image. But I think this is helpful in answering the question that I prefer to ask, the question of what Canada needs to understand its place in the world. And this diagram is adapted from a view, a theorem, an idea put forward by a Harvard scholar. Some of you will be familiar with him, Danny Roderick. It's an idea that's at least 10 years old now, but it's gained a lot of currency recently because he suggests, as you can probably decipher from the triangle, that any country looking to pursue each and all of the three policy objectives, deeper economic integration, national sovereignty, and democratic politics, can only achieve two of them. You can pick two, any two you like, but you can't get all three. You can't get all three if you want to pursue them in the fullest form. Now, I don't want to quibble about this theorem. There are lots of problems with it, and you can read up about it in your spare time. But I think it's a helpful way for us to think about the question I pose. What does Canada need to understand its place in the world? And many of the foreign policy and trade and economic policy and international policy challenges that we are wrestling with in Ottawa and Canadians are wrestling with have to do with this so-called impossibility theorem, or what he calls the global political trilemma. Choose two, only two, not three. And it's not difficult to see why there is this question of trade-offs. Think, for example, about an issue that my colleagues and I in the Senate are dealing with by the time I get to Ottawa tomorrow night. It's the passage of the CETA bill. This is the Canada-EU Comprehensive Economic Trade Agreement that was ratified by the Europeans. The House has passed it. It's now come to the Senate. It very likely will go through. But it's generated some debate in this country. Debate's been going on for some time. And it's a debate entirely about this political trilemma, the impossibility theorem. To the extent that we want deeper and closer and economic ties with the European countries, hence more market access, easier investment, better movement of peoples, deeper economic integration, we are going to have to sacrifice some national sovereignty. And to the extent that we enter into an agreement which is going to create conflict and therefore which will require adjudication and some way of settling disputes through panels or through arbitration that is not solely Canadian-based, we are, in some senses, sacrificing democratic politics. I'll give you another example, which is, again, very close to all of us here and very much in the news, and that's the renegotiation of NAFTA. Roland Paris has brought it up. It's going to be a really crucial issue for us. We don't quite know the trajectory of these discussions. But what is President Trump trying to do when he says he wants to renegotiate NAFTA? He's trying to reclaim national sovereignty. Another word for that is make America great again. By doing so, he wants to disentangle somewhat from deeper economic integration with Canada and particularly with Mexico. And we can talk about democratic politics and the deficit in the US as well. But these are the kinds of issues that I think, I don't want to be too abstract, I think these are important for us to think about as we ponder some of the very practical and concrete questions that both Shuvaloy and Roland have raised in terms of what we actually do in our foreign policy. Let me go to another point quickly, Laura, if you'll indulge me, also on the issue of what Canada needs to understand better our place in the world. I think we need to be more internationalist, and this may sound tautological, but I've observed in my nearly 40 years now, 30 plus years in Canada, that while Canada is recognized around the world as a very multicultural, internationally oriented country, when you're on the inside, we're actually very parochial. And if you just indulge me for a bit, I'll tell you why I think that's the case. I often work with immigrants from all over the world, particularly in this city, as you know, a very large number of them from different parts of Asia in particular, but elsewhere also, who have a great difficulty finding jobs, getting integrated into the community, but particularly into a profession. And the single biggest problem they face, they tell me, is that Canadian employers want Canadian experience. By definition, if you're immigrant, you ain't got Canadian experience. So you're already behind starting off. But here's the thing. In most of the places that I've been to and lived in and worked in, particularly global cities, internationally oriented cities, when I talk to employers about what they want, the first thing they look for is international experience. It's not German experience. It's not French experience. It's not Japanese experience, it's your experience internationally. Certainly, if you come to a country with international experience, that's an asset, it's not a liability. That's one measure. Second measure, this data is a little bit old, but the CBIE, the Canadian Bureau for International Education, some years ago put out a study suggesting that only 6% of Canadian students have an overseas experience as part of their post-secondary education. Only 6%. The comparable figures are higher for Australia, for Germany, for France, for UK, even for the United States. It's surprising, isn't it? And I think it goes to the point that I'm trying to make, that while we see ourselves as internationalists, while our government certainly has a reputation of being internationally engaged, in fact, Canadians are very parochial, and there are many other issues, many other examples that I can cite for why we need to fix this parochialism problem. What I'm getting at, ultimately, is we need to, as we think about our place in the world, as we think about how we contribute, how we show leadership, how we solve problems, how we expand and enhance our economic and political and diplomatic interests, the first thing we need to do is to look inside, figure out what's wrong, figure out how we solve some difficult trade-offs, and figure out how our own people, our own population, can be more internationally oriented. Thank you very much.
All right, you raised some provocative ideas, some that honestly cast me back to the great free trade agreement debate years ago, and we'll probably revisit that in the questions. Right. But finally, we hear from Sheila Watt-Cloutier.
Nakomik, Ilunasi. I, like Laura, is suffering from a bad cold. So I do feel a little bit mellow, but I will give it my best shot. I first want to acknowledge that I am speaking on the traditional lands of the Musqueam, the Tsleil-Waututh, and the Squamish. Indeed, the Arctic is where I come from, my homeland, a precious place that most people have not come to see or understand. But as Canadians, we do need to understand the Arctic and how it all connects back to the southern parts of Canada, but as well as the international communities, and how the changes that are happening in the Arctic are just very critical to Canada stepping up to the leadership on so many fronts. So the Arctic certainly is an area of utmost importance in the minds of many global policymakers, the economic decision makers, and the researchers. And this interest needs to be much better informed by awareness of what is happening to the largely indigenous and subsistence-oriented communities that provide that human face to the Arctic. These communities, our communities, are very small, there's no doubt. They don't have great political power or influence at the national and international levels, but they are the heart and the soul of the Arctic. And I want to walk you through a little bit of that human dimension, because I think it's an important piece that most Canadians have not come to fully embrace in terms of what we are struggling with up there. It's not just about the ice, it's not just about the polar bears, but it's about the families in those communities. And for us, of course, as Inuit, every challenging moment was an opportunity on that ice and that cold to teach our children how to become proficient providers and natural conservationists, but also about developing their own character and life skills. And Inuit culture teaches both very holistically, the technical and the character skills, in that very holistic manner, and it's never separated. So you're taught how to read the weather and the ice conditions and how to effectively become a great hunter or a great seamstress, but you learn also to become extremely focused and meticulous as your family depends on it for survival. So the technical skills that are taught are about how the world works, but the character building and the life skills of that ice in the Arctic is about how you work. And this holistic approach is the learning, of this kind of learning, the approach to that is the hallmark of Inuit culture. And so this wisdom, which is sourced from the ice and snow, is now equally, as you know, you've been hearing this over and over, and I understand Vancouver has already been experiencing some pretty strange weather patterns. From what I gather, the snow that we should be having up north has landed here all too frequently lately. So our environment, of course, as I say, the wisdom, though, that is often sourced from that ice and snow is equally now at stake in being lost as the ice itself. And that connection is really important for us as a people. Our environment and climate was very predictable and rich in lessons, and allowing our ingenious culture, of course, through traditional knowledge to be passed down generation to generation. However, the unpredictability now, of course, makes it very difficult to read, the traditional knowledge that we can no longer count on necessarily. Everything is changing. It's changing very rapidly. And globalization has hit the Arctic and its people, impacting our health, our culture, way of life, our environment, our climate. And as I say, as the ice goes, so does that wisdom. And everything is connected, as we all know this. You know, I know that I'm probably speaking to many here who are, you know, already converted and understand this issue, but I don't think you can, you know, signal these messages from the Arctic too often. And so everything is connected through our common atmosphere. What affects another affects us all. And as the Arctic melts, other places, such as the small island developing states, are sinking. As we know, the Arctic is that cooling system for the planet, and it is impacting in many ways. And we know in our own country, the floods that have been happening, the wildfires out west that have been happening, you name it, anywhere from Canada to Australia to the fishermen in Gulf of Mexico to the homeowners in New Orleans, the devastation escalates and we're all very connected to what's happening. And so the world I knew, you know, living traditionally and traveling only by dog team the first 10 years of my life, and I didn't know any English till I was six, have changed so rapidly, just in one lifetime. And climate change in the Arctic is not just an environmental issue, it is one with very unwelcome economic consequences as well. It's a case of livelihood, it's food, it's individual and cultural survival. It's a human issue affecting our children, our families, and our communities. And the Arctic is not just a wilderness waiting to be once again exploited. It's our home, and it's our homeland. And all these challenges that we're facing is not necessarily of our doing up in the Arctic. We've benefited the least from industry, and we are the most disproportionately negatively impacted by the effects of globalization. So how sad and ironic that is, that people who have lived sustainably for millennia, far from the source of pollutants that make their way up into the Arctic and the greenhouse gases that are now being emitted out there, would bear the brunt of their damaging effects. So for too long, we have asked the world to stop hurting our way of life, and for too long, the world has responded that it is too expensive to stop bringing harm to our way of life. So Inuit are being asked to pay the price for the unsustainable choices most of the world continues to want to maintain. In fact, we are becoming the collateral damage as a result of irresponsible political actions, or should I say inactions. And so everyone benefits from a frozen Arctic, and everything is connected. And we can no longer separate the importance of the value of the Arctic from the sustainable growth of economies around the world. And I believe, and I pioneered this work on connecting climate change to human rights, that it's through the power of human rights, of this approach of human rights, that we can move that discussion out of the realm of dry economic and technical debate that all very often, too often, overtakes discussion on so many levels. And I think this human rights-based approach takes that path of principle. We're Canadians. We know about standing on principle, and we need to maintain that. And showing us that fundamental change is not just sound policy, but it certainly is ethical imperative. I've seen the power of this approach in my global work that I did when I was elected with the ICC, as we drew out for the first time the links between Arctic climate change and our environmental, cultural, and human rights. I saw how the world enthusiastically connected to and welcomed our work. And why is that? Because people can relate to the issue when you bring it to the human dimension. We're all in this together. And in the international arenas where I have personally been involved, the language of economics and technology is always calling for further delay. Oftentimes we get sidelined. The issues that are so critical get sidelined because of sometimes the politics that gets involved in what we consider to be so vital to take action, but yet the delays keep coming. And for all kinds of different reasons. And we're constantly reminded how taking action on greenhouse emissions will negatively impact our economy. I think, though, reframing the debate in terms of fundamental human rights and the connections between environmental change and cultural rights refocuses the debate on humanity and not just economy. So I do believe that we must reframe that, the terms of the debate over climate action. There's no doubt about that. And this approach of focusing climate change solely to economics tends to silo and separate these issues. And that's just the structure of our political system as well, is separating one another as opposed to recognizing the connections between rights, environment, health, economies, and society. So certainly, and I'm not trying to just make the plug for my book, but defending the right to be cold, the Inuit right to be cold, is about connectivity. And it is about how we are all inextricably connected by this fundamental human right. A right which I believe Canada's focus and attention and care in defending should be there. You know, someone mentioned a few minutes ago about Russia, you know, taking its, we know the titanium flag that was put at the bottom of the Arctic sink. We hear about all of these things up in the Arctic and we think, well, wait a minute. This is our homeland that we're talking about. This is about our children and the future of them. I have two grandsons who live in Iqaluit and who were raised there, who are being raised there. And so it really is about the families who are trying to make it in this new world order of globalization. I have seen Canada step up to the plate firsthand, working directly with them during the time when we were negotiating the persistent organic pollutants, toxins that end up in our food chain, poisoning the nursing milk of our mothers. And what a world we had created when Inuit women had to think twice about nursing their babies as a result of toxins coming through the weather patterns. I've seen the globe come together where Canada, working with its indigenous peoples across this country, made a mark and led to the successful Stockholm Convention. So I know that Canada can lead, has that potential once again to take that lead, in particularly now, where there is such a void and such a contentious issue with the leadership that is now coming into play. And Canada has to pull itself out of that teenage and not just follow. We need to now step up. And this is a good time to do that. And so the Arctic wants to rely. And of course, with the climate change issues and the negotiations that are ongoing around the world, the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, we need to be part of that. You need to tap into the people that are most affected by that. And again, Canada, it's a great time now, while others are back to 20 years ago dismissing the issue of climate change and being skeptical about science and the observations that our Inuit hunters live with every single day as they continue now to fall through the thinning ice in more numbers than they ever have as a result of these changes that are happening. So indeed, we need to rely on Canada, and we need to have our politicians step up to that plate once again as the people of the Arctic, who are now going to be exploited again for the riches that lie beneath that melting ice and the Northwest Passage that is now becoming more accessible for the shipping that is going to come through and benefit the larger world, but not necessarily for us. In fact, there will be more devastation. So instead of seeing these things as opportunities, we have to see it as an environmental devastation that is happening to the Arctic and to the culture of the people and the wisdom that will be gone, because it is the issue of climate change and the disconnect that we have in the urban settings very often, that the disconnect between ourselves, each other, our environment, our food source, that is creating this debate on climate change in the first place. So let's push our politicians even further to ensure that they are going to protect the Arctic, not just for the people of the Arctic, but how the Arctic connects back to everywhere else. The Arctic, whatever happens there, does not stay there. It is affecting us all on this planet. So, Nakomik, thank you.
Well, I think we had quite a range of views there from the very, very lofty heights of foreign policy and a global view right down to the fishermen who are falling through the ice. So we've got a lot to discuss here. Just before we get to it, I just want to remind you, if you want to pose your own questions, it is slido.com. And the event is Who Needs Canada? If you need to put the event partner in to pose your own questions. Shuvaloy, I'd like to get started with you because you were the first person who spoke, and you were very prescriptive with a lot of what you said about what you see Canada needing to do, but I was hearing ideas instead of actual actions that you see Canada taking. So I'd like to hear from you some practical things that you think Canada can do. And the thing I also want to ask you is, in sort of a realistic way of, and the skeptical journalist, is how much influence does Canada really have on the world stage?
Well, we had the constraint of 5 minutes. And I worry that I would have bored everybody in the room by going through a detailed plan around each. But I don't think that those ideas were absent a foundation of actual actions that could be taken on. And whether it's, distilling it down to each of these individual themes, there's a lot that Canada can and should be doing, but as you note, is constrained by our own size and our own effect in the world. I would argue that the world has been shifting so much just on a geopolitical level from the idea of a two-way war, a Cold War, into a multipolar world. And as that multipolar world begins to emerge with Washington taking a lesser burden for global peace and security and a stronger mandate for national sovereignty, others will fill that vacuum. And in that vacuum is an opportunity and a risk for Canada alike. And so as you look at the diminishing role of the United States in the Middle East, the partnerships that Canada would have to curate in the region would need to constrain some of the more belligerent actors, whether they're sponsors of terrorism, as we've seen in Daesh or ISIS, more of the Sunni militant variety, or the state-sponsored manufacturing of terrorism emanating from Tehran. There is a lot that Canada can and should be doing and meaningfully contributing towards constraining Iran's corrosive environment role in that region.
Such as?
Sanctions on the IRGC, expanding it from the Quds Force, which is one sect of the IRGC, the militant wing of the Revolutionary Guard, to the entire Revolutionary Guard. Treating with suspicion its nuclear ambitions rather than embracing the idea that somehow Iran has transformed in the last years into a stable partner for prosperity in the region. Challenging Iran's own human rights record internally, which is the worst in the region, on behalf of the advocates for democracy in the country. Looking at constraining Iran's reach, not just in southern Lebanon, but its role as partners of Russia in Syria, and its continued influence in Baghdad as it consolidates control over its hold across a large arch in the region and increases appropriate security concern, from the countries in the Gulf or with our partner and our ally in Israel. Those are some specific ideas. We can continue going further into each of them.
I hear what you're saying, and some of it sounds like a continuation of what the previous Harper government had done in its relationship with Iran in particular. But I wonder if Iran just turns around and shrugs its shoulders and says, who cares?
Well, I think that's something that, you know, the special forces that have been deployed by the previous government and continued and expanded by the current government are focusing on trying to find ways to help Iraq maintain its own sense of sovereignty, to help the Kurdistan regional government repel the militant elements of ISIS that have been operating in northern Iraq, and playing a support role to other actors inside Syria. That's a good thing that I think has been extended. A lot of what we see coming from Iran requires appropriate suspicion. I think there's two different interpretations of what's happening in Tehran. One is the idea that it is a predictable actor, appropriately concerned about its place in the region because of the powers that are affecting its own behavior, and is exercising its national interests in a rational way. The other is to view Tehran as a clerical military dictatorship that affords no choice for its citizens in these pantomime democracy that it affords to its own citizens, that it is restraining the pool of people that could help lead the path to how the country could integrate economically in the region responsibly, how it could abate the concerns that the world appropriately has about its own nuclear aspirations. And it depends on which perspective you have of what's happening in Tehran. So there's a lot that can happen in both Iran, but beyond the world, and some of the more belligerent actors, whether it's Russia or China.
I'm sensing one of you wants to jump in.
If I could ask, Shuvaloy and Roland may want to jump in as well. I mean, I'm sure you know that the current government is embarking on a process of diplomatic normalization with Iran and wants to reestablish our embassy in Tehran. There was great hardship caused to Canadians of Iranian descent and other actors in civil society and the business community and the NGO community because we don't have a diplomatic presence in Tehran. Most of the people I've talked to believe that this act of sanctions, it's a bill that's in the Senate right now, so I know it very, very well, will not only jeopardize, it will scuttle our diplomatic efforts to reestablish. Is it worth that effort?
You know, the kind of advocacy that you've been exposed to might indicate the kind of networked echo chambers we all tend to exist in, because I've heard exactly the opposite, where...
No, but the question I'm asking is, do you think that the sanctions will allow us to continue to reestablish diplomatic relations with Iran, or do you not care about that?
No, I think the sanctions regime has been really important. I mean, it was a sanctions regime that economically isolated some of the worst actors in Iran, often governed by the IRGC and their assets, these companies that they control, from being able to participate in the global marketplace. Iran's economic position was one of the main causes for why it wanted to be in a position to negotiate with Washington in the first place. Now, there's a lot that we can discuss in, with respect to the P5+1 negotiations that led to the so-called nuclear deal, but I don't think that there is any reason to lessen economic sanctions on Iran until it's actually complied.
I don't want to get too bogged down in this one point, but Roland, did you have something that you wanted to say?
Well, I also don't want to turn this into this Iran panel. I mean, I'm having a little bit of PTSD thinking about your former boss, John Baird, and his Iran fixation, but I'll leave it at that. I think that there are... We have to be mindful of a few things. One is that there are some enduring goals in Canadian foreign policy, regardless of the government. We use our foreign policy to promote, first and foremost, the security and the prosperity and the well-being of our population. Okay? Let's just put that out there. That's the first goal. The second goal is for Canada to be a constructive actor in addressing specific global problems that matter to Canadians. And we've done that very well, too. And the third goal that's also enduring is to contribute to the maintenance of a rules-based international order founded on relationships, institutions, and alliances. And that includes a range of institutions, the rules of the world trading system, the United Nations, and a whole alphabet soup of organizational acronyms. All of those things are part of our foreign policy and enduring goals. The challenge is to take the changing circumstances and use the changing circumstances as the lens through which we define a strategy at a particular moment to achieve those enduring goals. If we look at the second thing, for example, which is the second goal, which is to make a useful and a constructive contribution to addressing global problems, here is where we take some of the discussion about how Canada can be a, you know, does the world need more Canada, which it does, where that discussion immediately needs to be turned into concrete specifics. We can't do everything. If we do everything, we'll do nothing. So defining areas that make sense for Canada. Let me give you a specific example. We have a particular interest in this country in the rights of people who have been forcibly displaced from their homelands, refugees. And right now, the world is experiencing an unprecedented emergency in the number of people who have been forcibly displaced. We've done our part a little bit. 40,000 Syrian refugees. That has been recognized and acknowledged and welcomed, but it's still a very small number. There is still an enormous problem out there. The system, the global system for dealing with this emergency is not suited to the scale of the emergency that we're seeing.
So what's Canada's role then? Do you want to see Canada accept 500,000?
Well,
refugees?
See, this is it. We default to, like, okay, so let's just do more of what we're doing. Number one, there needs to be a serious effort to provide education, job skills, and employment to the millions of young people who are in these forced displacement situations. If they don't have hope for the future, then they are like a time bomb of hopelessness that will only create ongoing problems going forward. So what does Canada bring to the table? You ask about influence. Canada is not a great power, but we have the ability to rally together coalitions of actors. We have a brand which actually counts for something, and we could pull together a coalition of like-minded states, international organizations, NGOs, private foundations, with, for example, the goal of providing 100% of refugee youth enforced in these chronic displacement situations with quality primary education. It's ambitious.
In the camps, you're saying, where they're living. Is that what you're
saying? I'm giving this as an example.
It's, no, I know, but yeah, I'm just trying to understand how something like
camps,
this would work.
The profile of refugees has changed. Most of them are not in camps anymore. And so that is what makes this
a lot of them
challenge.
Are sitting in Beirut with no real hope
Scattered.
Of any future.
Yep.
Okay, I wanted to come over to Sheila Watt-Cloutier because you're coming at this with quite a different lens. And when you look at Canada and who needs Canada, you focus quite rightly so on climate change and what it means to people who are living in the north. You seem to be, in your remarks, praising Canada and for its role and what it's done in the past. Do you feel that Canada has the moral authority to keep pushing on that agenda in the future? And do you sense that this current government will do that?
Well, it certainly had good intentions to do that. Let's put it that way. Because I think we have a leader who really wants to make a difference. But again, like everywhere else in governments, there's a ball and chain issue here that where he is somehow slowed down by the politics of our provinces and so on, not to be able to move as quickly as he'd wanted to. So, you know, that's the reality of Canada as well. And I know that the Arctic issues are put on the back burner once again as a result of that. And there isn't as quick of an action taken by our governments as a result of all that has to be dealt with within our own country even. You know, I hear all of these voices coming in about, you know, the displaced people that we need to help, and, you know, we are the first people who are open to helping others. We know what it's like.
You're displaced.
Displaced, yes. In our own country. We know what it's like in our communities to have no running water, in the First Nations communities in particular, not for a week or a month, but for decades. We know that these issues of poverty and hunger, there has been a report that came out just a couple of years ago that the Inuit of the Arctic are the hungriest in this country. We know that we are being the most negatively impacted disproportionately, as I mentioned in my talk, on the issues of environment and climatic changes that are impacting at the very human core, the human level. We have the highest suicide rates in North America, in my world, the Inuit world. Our education systems are abysmal. They're so disconnected. The social and health issues, the social indicators are not getting any better. If we had a government domestically, even here, to deal with the issues that we're dealing with, housing and all of the rest of it, we would be far better off being able to contribute even more to Canadian society. But the 150 years is not necessarily a celebration for many of us because of that reality that exists in our communities. But we are still very open. I know I can speak from my own experience as an Inuk, but from many leaders who have said, we consider ourselves staunch Canadians, and we're proud of that in the Arctic. But at the same time, we feel that we are living third world conditions in our own country many times, and that we are forgotten by our own government, who are, knowing that they have to partake, of course, in the international politics, and it's all about give and take with other countries of the world, but let's look after our own as well, equally.
It's interesting because Powell accused us, I wouldn't say accused, but suggested that we're probably just too parochial as Canadians, and Sheila's saying we're not looking inward enough to our own problems. How do you square that circle?
Well, no, I think you squared it for us. You know, we're not looking enough at our own problems. And you know, it connects, I think, in some senses to the discussion we just had on this side of the stage about Canada, being a champion on human rights issues, which we have to be. It's a part of our makeup. But we tend to focus, as in this discussion on Iran, on civil and political rights, and we tend to neglect the other covenant, the other UN covenant on human rights, which is on economic, social, and cultural rights, which is what Sheila's talking about. And we don't have to look very far at all to recognize that we fall short on some very fundamental human rights in this country. This
and
is not about moral equivalence.
And that's what brings me around to ask whether we have the moral authority to speak on the world stage.
You know, I mean, we have to be very humble about this. I'm not saying that we, you know, we don't call out injustice, we don't call out, abuses, gross abuses of human rights in other places, but we have to be very humble about it, and we have to think very hard about, first of all, the things that Roland said, you know, what are our objectives, the enduring objectives of foreign policy, and then we have to think about efficacy. Efficacy counts. It may make us feel virtuous to stand up and announce sanctions or to condemn someone, to use megaphone diplomacy, but if there is no effectiveness, if we're going it, and going it alone, which almost guarantees that there won't be effectiveness, then really it's self-aggrandizement more than anything.
Well, that brings me to a question that I've been dying to ask Roland, because you're the one who has had the ear most recently of the Prime Minister, and you watched his performance down in Washington with President Trump. I know there were some who were frustrated when they didn't see Trudeau stand up to Trump and speak forcefully about what Canadians fundamentally disagreed with him about. What did you think of the way he handled that exchange with Trump? Was it necessary to be that way with the president? Does it presage that the relationship will always be that way?
Yeah, I don't think the relationship will always be that way. I thought it was a very successful meeting on a number of different levels. Huge amount of work went into prepare that, of course. There was contact by senior aides to Justin Trudeau, directly to senior advisors to Donald Trump. And those contacts, there was a channel of communication that was established early when many other countries were not even sure what phone number to dial. There was a cabinet shuffle to readjust the team. There was the mobilization of allies, right, throughout the US political system, and of Canadians to mobilize their networks as well. All with a single message for the purposes of that first meeting, which was largely an economic message. The message being that the United States has an interest in the bilateral economic relationship with Canada. And you will have heard the messages repeated over and over again about 35 states having Canada as its principal trading partner, 9 million jobs in the United States. And on that level, the ultimate indication that though that effort was successful was that the president himself, in his remarks, used those figures and they were in the joint statement. But of course, you know, for Justin Trudeau and for any Canadian Prime Minister in that situation, he needs both to create a working relationship with the president and to be standing up for Canadian values and interests. And what he chose to do was to stand in the White House beside the president and say, I'm not here to lecture you, which by the way implies that there is something to lecture about, but here is the way that our approach is one of openness. That, I'm paraphrasing him obviously here, that is the approach that Canadians expect me to take, and it's one that can provide a model. So everybody reaches their own conclusion about whether he struck the right balance there. To me, standing in the White House beside the President of the United States and basically articulating a very different view framed as here is reaffirming what Canada believes was an implicit rebuke. Some people wanted it to be explicit. What would that have accomplished at that moment? There may be a time in the future, speaking obviously just for myself, when I think that the Prime Minister or the Government of Canada might have to be more direct and pointed in its criticism of Donald Trump. It totally depends on what Trump does.
Anyone else want to weigh in on that?
No, I thought that the Prime Minister did a masterful job with an unwieldy administration, at least in its first 100 days. It requires, I mean, the relationship between Canada and the United States really falls on the shoulders of the Prime Minister to be able to deliver that successfully. And so much of our national life is vested in a successful relationship there. It's an interesting dichotomy from what the previous administration experienced and the current administration is experiencing here in Ottawa or in Canada. I think that what Prime Minister Trudeau did was effective to secure the bilateral relationship. A lot of what we saw coming from the presidential campaign in the United States hadn't seen a criticism of President Trump with respect to the Canada-US relationship. The migration and security issues that the White House had been signaling is almost exclusively related to Mexico. And so that creates an obvious discomfort for Canada as part of a broader agreement that we have a vested stake in. But I don't think that there should be much reason to be concerned about the Canada-US economic partnership. The big concern will be geopolitical, where there are major cleavages between Washington and Ottawa on attitudes towards things like Tehran, on Beijing, on Russia itself, on climate change. There's a vast array of thorny issues on the world stage, where I think Prime Minister Trudeau will have to navigate Canada's national interests and values and various interpretations of it at home with what President Trump actually does, as Roland said.
That's where it gets very tricky.
And if I can jump in, I agree with that. And those differences are going to have to be managed, and that's going to be complex. But I would say that we can't take anything for granted, even on the economic relationship with the United States. Trump is unpredictable. If he started tweeting about companies that were investing in Canada to serve the American market, that would have serious potential ramifications for our economy. And so, every country in the world, including Canada, is now face to face with a president, who could, in one tweet, can turn the relationship upside down. So we have to be, government needs to be vigilant and ready to vigorously defend Canada's interests.
Oh, did you have something else to add? All right, I think we have the Slido questions. I'm very excited about this. Thank you. I'm not being very high-tech about this. All right, the number one question. I'm learning this as I read it.
Suspense is killing.
Yeah, no kidding. What is the most important under-discussed foreign policy issue that Canadians ought to care about? And it's not aimed at anyone in particular, so whoever wants to answer that. What is the most important under-discussed foreign policy issue that Canadians ought to care about?
I'll take a stab at it.
Go ahead.
Technology. I think artificial intelligence, machine learning, the ways in which technology will affect the industrial development of the developing world, the questions of security that technology poses, the idea of norms, the global norms around how technology is governed has yet to be set. In fact, are often being set outside of government. During the Cold War, you had state investments and state regulation of nuclear technology, which made it somewhat predictable in terms of being able to control how the advent of nuclear technology would be mainstreamed over the course of the last 50, 60 years. The world of the future is very different than the one that we've come from. And the idea of how global norms will be established around the governance of technology and its intellectual property, its privacy, channel the benefits of its great commercial potential for the world over, particularly for billions of people, to be able to lift themselves out of poverty, and how we in the West respond to technology, not just in our defense of our liberties and our freedoms, but to defend it from malignant actors who seek to exploit our own political terrain through abusing technology, or even undermining our commercial competitiveness.
Well, it's actually interesting because you bringing that up brings up what you were talking about, how with the deeper economic integration, deeper technological integration would also seem to damage our ability to be sovereign.
Yes, but the challenge will come not from other sovereigns, but from more amorphous entities, some of which are captured in traditional corporations, others in distributed networks that have no discernible lead or organization. So the job of developing regulations and policing and monitoring becomes much more difficult. It is a challenge of sovereignty and one that's driven, as Shuvaloy says, by technological innovation.
Anyone else want to venture a view about what we don't pay enough attention to? Oh,
if I may, just quickly,
I
think I was going to say elephant in the room, but I guess it's the dragon in the room, is the global power shift. And it's been alluded to already, the shift in the post-Cold War period from a unipolar world, led by the United States, to a more multipolar world, and one in which the primacy of the United States is being diminished. In some senses, the Trump problem, if you want to frame it that way, is not uniquely a Trump problem. It's a problem of declining American influence in the world. And whoever became in the last election, and whoever continues to run the United States, is going to face this challenge of American primacy being eroded, not by any means being supplanted, don't get me wrong, but certainly being eroded by the rise of emerging powers, particularly China. And currently, our approach to China is very much a transactional approach. It's about how can we get more market share in China? How can we get more investment? How can we sell more beef? You know, all of which are, you know, good objectives. But we haven't wrestled with the central question. And this is the question of how growing economic power inevitably will spill over, for better or worse, into growing political and military power and the desire for a change in global institutions. That conversation has not been had in this country. Global institutions that we have lived under and benefited from, the Bretton Woods organizations, the IMF and the World Bank, of course, but the rules by which the Western world has existed and thrived for many years. The powers that are emerging were not at the creation of these institutions in the immediate post-war period. It's understandable that they want to either tweak the rules of the existing system or change them altogether. And this is a conversation that's very uncomfortable because it clashes with our values about what we think Canada is and what we value and so on. We know China is an authoritarian state that regularly abuses human rights and does not allow freedom of the press and many other civil freedoms. But there's no question that the Chinese government wants to be more assertive, and one way in which it'll be more assertive is in the rules of the game, so to speak.
It's very interesting. I was interviewing Richard Haass a couple of weeks ago on the Current, and he has written about this, and he calls what we are living in now is a world in disarray because of these very things, and trying to re-examine what the institutions are and how we should regulate relations among nations. Roland?
I agree that this is the overlay, and we're experiencing right now historic shifts, transformations in the international system, and we've seen them before, but never in the way that we're seeing them now, and they're accelerated now more than ever before. And, you know, having this discussion is important, but I think one of the, if you're coming back to the question, the kind of under-discussed foreign policy issue is that it's about domestic politics. And our ability to engage in this discussion internationally depends in part on having the consent of our populations to sustain a set of institutions that are still largely open trade, rules that are applicable everywhere. And, you know, after World War II, when the existing structure of international institutions was created, it was partly based on a bargain that there would be open trade, that we would be spending money, and particularly the United States would be spending money to underwrite this system, which is both a security system and a system of rules and a trading system. And the implicit bargain was, in exchange, your life will get better, and your children will have a better life too. And it's that deal that's in question now in many places, particularly in the communities that disproportionately supported Donald Trump, but not exclusively there. And there are signs that that could be a problem in Canada too. So in some weird way, our ability to address the adjustment of the international order, which will be a huge generational challenge for all of us, depends on maintaining the deal with our populations and taking seriously the concerns that fueled Brexit and have fueled Trump, and addressing those concerns.
Well, you've just given me the perfect segue to the next question.
There you go.
And unlike the Oscars, we actually are keeping count of the votes, and we will reveal them publicly. So number two by just three votes was this question. How critical is electoral reform to maintain Canadians' faith in democracy and prevent our slide into enraged populism.
Can we talk about this for like several hours?
Anybody want to have a go at that? We were talking a bit about this backstage, where this might lead, so.
You know, it's part of my impossibility triangle, right? You know, on the bottom right corner of the triangle is domestic politics, democratic politics. And what that part of the triangle says is that, on the one hand, if you get deeper integrated into world economy, you are going to give up some ability to influence the people who make the decisions, or the people who arbitrate, the people who set the rules, so to speak. They're going to be done by people in Brussels or in New York or in Geneva or wherever it might be, and that's the erosion or the corrosion of domestic politics. But there's another part to it, and the other part is what Roland talked about, which is that there's a delegitimization of politics because people don't feel that their vote matters. One, because maybe they're losing out, it's because of a pure economic calculus, and the other is because the vote doesn't count. So I'm very personally very disappointed that we did not get the promised electoral reform. And you know,
you gonna do anything about that, Senator?
Welcome to public life.
Independent senator with no political caucus. But corrosion of faith in our democratic systems is key. It's what Roland talked about. Without that, we will not be able to deal with the problems that Sheila has talked about. We will not be able to maintain the openness that we talked about. We will not be able to provide leadership on foreign policy issues because there will be no support for it.
If I could add to that. You know, when there is a problem in public discourse, one group of people run to trying to diagnose the matter of process that might be associated with it, in this case, electoral reform. And the other group of people run to the notion of how we have our debates. And I think all of us have mentioned this at the beginning, but I think it's important to note this in the post-Brexit, current Trump world that we're in. The gap between rich and poor, the people who've benefited from globalization, the people who have not been able to access that prosperity, is widening, not shrinking. Debate is being characterized as echo chambers amongst both communities. People who believe one set of values and views are talking and accelerating their own opinions amongst each other's own domains, but dialogue between the two are not necessarily there. One side is characterized by condescension towards the other. Meanwhile, the other side is characterized by anger towards the former. It creates this environment where the idea of pluralism itself, which is becoming a guise for normative moral relativism, the idea that, you know, there's only one truth and the others are not truth because this is how truth is going to be, no matter what, has become dominant in public discourse and established democracies, where I think, Senator, it is challenging our very way of life. The idea that we actually debate and defer with each other substantively and respectfully is one that is an art that is becoming lost, and one that I think this community summit is addressing quite effectively, because I think there are ways in which very different perspectives can be disagreeably agreeable or agreeably disagreeable. I think in Washington right now you're seeing the benefits of the short-term tyranny of getting that quick soundbite, driving the news agenda, becoming the norm, and I'm concerned
we're
going to see that in Paris soon.
Right.
I'm concerned we're going to see that in Germany soon. And we're going to see worse and worse forms of it in Holland or elsewhere as elections evolve. And so one of the great examples of Canadian pluralism is our capacity to embrace the other and to do so with respect and not afford that disdain that comes with it. And so I have confidence that we don't need to pursue electoral reform in Canada because we have strong institutions and a vibrant democratic system. And we should embrace it.
Sheila, I think
the people of the Arctic and the North would kind of disagree with that. Our Aboriginal communities. Our Aboriginal communities in this country would likely not agree with much of that, but because our reality is so different. You know, here we are, proud Canadians, but yet
We have many communities that are just, the basic needs are still missing. And I can't stress that enough in terms of what we have to do in our own country to address these issues. And you know, there are examples of how, you know, your first question, going back to it, the issues of climate change, okay, they're in the media, and I think the media tends to push the politicians to say even more about these issues. But, you know, they were not part of the campaign of the last election. They have not been part of the dialogue that happened between Trudeau and Trump, for obvious reasons. I understand that. I get that. But at the same time, they will have to be addressed. So, again, we always feel as though we are being left behind by the leadership when we feel the domestic issues are there. Yes, indeed, they are not addressed. But it's not an either-or issue either. Just because Canada is not addressing its domestic issues with Aboriginal peoples of this country doesn't mean that we can't go and lead at the international level, because we as Indigenous peoples who are affected by WTO issues, by the United Nations Environment Program issues, with the health of our country food and what we're dealing with the toxins issue that are still in our wildlife and in our food chain, and we're dealing with climatic changes that are so stark that many people have not come to fully understand what that means for us. This is just the tip of the iceberg of the 5 minutes that I gave you.
So to speak.
There's, yeah, you know, the pun intended.
Tip of the melting.
But, you know, but we need to have this front and center, and it can't be just politics that sets the stage for that. That's why I speak to civil society across this country and the world, and that's why I wrote the book, to try to piece together the dots that are so needed for political leadership to run with this, because if we think we have problems now with our economy, if we don't address these issues of climate change and what it means for a people who sit at the top of the world, who depend on that cold and the snow, then we are in for a ride, not just not necessarily for our generation, but for our children and our grandchildren.
I'm curious to know, when it comes back to this, the question of electoral reform, which is a domestic issue, yeah, but I understand why, yeah, it's being brought forward as a springboard to Canada on the international stage. Would you feel as though the people who you exist with in the North would have more of a say if there was some sort of electoral reform, that you would be listened to and that you would be made a priority?
Well, certainly we would hope that would be the case if there were changes. But I want to give you another example. Like, you know, when you have a few minutes, you just kind of go back to what you need to say. And so I don't take this opportunity to say it. But when you know, an example of our own domestic policies, which do connect with international policies, of course, the fine example that most people have not understood either or have heard of is the issue of, for example, the seismic testing that's happening in the Arctic and the small community of Clyde River that is not going to be heard by the Supreme Court of Canada. How many people in this room have heard of this? Mm. Very few, I bet. You know, very few. But this is an issue where there's that disconnect once again, where our own country's policies and politicians have not been there and have overrode the voices of the people who live and depend on the well-being of that environment and that ice, and so are now going for international help with whether it's Greenpeace, who, you know, have been a very difficult history with them, have now reached for people who are able to help them, and gone now to be heard by the Supreme Court. They've been heard, and now we will see what the ruling will say. But that's what I mean by the disconnect of our own government, to not be there for the people who are the original peoples of this country, and yet be out there, you know, supporting many others who we feel need that support. But let's start at home as well. And that's those are the issues of climate change and
all the poverty and the hunger that goes on in the Arctic. And those are, and foreign policy, I mean, we've been very successful. As I say, very few people know the success of how our government came to be in translating the science and the and all of that we had here in the country with the toxins issue and a health issue for the peoples of the North and anybody in between that was getting impacted by the toxins in their food chain. Not just for the North, but especially for the North, who became the net recipients. We were able to, with our own Canadian government and Indigenous leaders in Canada, translate that science into international policy, which is the Stockholm Convention, that helps all of us in this room and in the Arctic have safer food to eat that is not laced with toxins coming from afar. So, you know, I may be very different in how I'm relaying some of these messages, but these are at the human level that I'm talking about that we are faced with every day.
Yeah. All right. So this question, I think, kind of touches on the face that Canada presents to the world, in a sense. This is the number three question. Canada, and Vancouver especially, is a very multicultural place, yet cultural segregation is still very apparent. How do we promote cultural unity and open-mindedness?
Well, I'm the only Vancouver right here. It turns out that this is the day three or day four of 101 days of anti-racism, I think, something like that. And the city is very involved in this campaign. And I spoke at an event just a few days ago on this very question of, you know, do we still have a persistent problem of discrimination in this city, particularly with respect to immigrants, and how can we deal with it, and so on. And I think it's a very difficult question, but I think the first thing we need to say about this issue of demographic change in Vancouver is how successful it's been. Let's not lose sight of the fact that setting aside the head tax, the Exclusion Act, the internment, all the horror stories of the first half of the 20th century, the second half has been pretty good. And when you think about how dramatically the population of the Lower Mainland has changed in the last 30, 40 years. Dramatic, dramatic change, not just in numbers, but in the composition. People from very different parts of the world with very different backgrounds. That this was able to happen here in a North American city with such success, we should be very proud of ourselves. I think that's the first thing we need to remember. But we've reached a point where it's going to get harder. The incremental gains are going to be harder. They're going to be harder because, in part because, how to put this, visible minorities will soon no longer be visible minorities. The statistic is that by 2031, the so-called visible minorities will be the visible majority. Mind you, StatsCan will still call us visible minorities because they don't have a different category for it. And I think that's creating some tensions around how we organize ourselves, what our norms are, what social practices are. And this is where I think we need to reframe the debate around what is the established practice and who needs to adjust. The point I made in this other forum was that we need to rethink the idea of integration, not as a set of practices into which newcomers have to embrace fully, but integration as a set of activities to help us all advance through mutual understanding and compromise and so on. Because the reality is this, apart from the First Nations people, this is trite, I know, but it's true, there really are no old stock people in British Columbia. I don't think so. I mean, if you think about the Japanese or the Punjabis or the Chinese, they've been here as long as Vancouver has been here. And they have as much a claim to be part of the old stock, if you will, if you must use that term, than what others might traditionally think of as old stock. So we are embarking on a really bold and exciting experiment here in Vancouver where we will be the first major Western city that will become, that will go from being predominantly European white to one that will be not European white. We've done a great job so far. I think we can continue to
And does that set an example for the world?
Yes, absolutely. And that's one of the things that I think others touched on it in terms of where we have leadership, where we can show leadership, is in our practice of multiculturalism and openness.
Okay, I want to get to question number four because it is the last one and we really don't have very much time left. It sort of follows on from the last question. How can cities like Vancouver make a difference in foreign affairs, especially given the rise of cities as drivers of growth?
Well, it's interesting because we were talking before about changes that are taking place in the way that international affairs is conducted, and one of those changes that we've seen is just the emergence of a lot more different kinds of actors. It's not just states that are active anymore, and cities are already part of powerful networks in dealing with climate change, for example. I've had interesting conversations with a wonderful woman named Jennifer Kiesmat, who's the chief planner of the City of Toronto. And in her view, there are ways in which Canadian cities could be sharing expertise with some cities in the developing world in specific areas where Canada has been managing quite well, including the management, including the ways in which Canadian cities think about integration, mixing, living together. And even prosaic things like water systems. Yeah. So I think that there are a lot of opportunities for big cities like Vancouver in a country like this one to be playing ever bigger roles in international affairs. And then let me just come back to an earlier point that I made, because I think it's worth underlining that as the world gets more crowded, as new countries are rising to prominence, as non-state actors, whether they're private foundations or NGOs or subnational governments, including cities, play a more and more important role, it's going to get harder to get things done, to deal with specific problems. And to get things done, more and more, we're going to need coalitions, broad groupings of like-minded actors working towards specific goals. And it may be coalitions of foundations and NGOs and cities and international organizations. It may be dealing with the problem of climate change and how it affects cities in particular, for example. Canada is extremely well placed to mobilize coalitions to deal with international problems. It is a comparative advantage for Canada. We've done it before. But frankly, our foreign service is a bit out of exercise in doing this kind of work. And we need to encourage, I think, our political leaders to make sure that our foreign service experts, who are wonderful professionals, are working to mobilize the coalitions that can really help Canada to achieve the practical solutions to some of these problems that we've been discussing.
Any other short interventions from anyone else?
No, I'll add to it. I mean, Vancouver as a city is an extraordinary example for the world. I love this city. I come from Calgary and I still love Vancouver. I have a lot of admiration for here. The one thing I would want to add to what Roland had contributed to this was much of Canadian foreign policy and the Foreign Service, which is an excellent group of individuals, has some intrinsic institutional problems. Canada's identity has been so wrapped up in an Atlantic presence through the institutions that are eastward facing from Ottawa that sometimes the Pacific and its enormous opportunity gets neglected. And Vancouver's 3 hours away, and it takes forever to wait till somebody wakes up here to talk to them. There's some enormously practical considerations about our beautiful, large country. One of the great opportunities is, in this Asian century to come, is for Vancouver to, in places like SFU or others, in the chambers of commerce, in the public policy places, I think Stuart Beck is here from the Asia Pacific Foundation, which the senator once led, is to really elevate that voice about what Canada's interests are in the Indo-Pacific region, both on a trade basis, on the idea of what Canada's security contribution should be in the region, which is historic, it goes back to Korea and the Second World War in Hong Kong, and even more importantly, in enabling the people of Vancouver to be that connective tissue that deepens our opportunity in that region.
All right, I'm going to end it there and get you to initially thank these panelists for running for their great discussion. I want to remind you that, you know, it's not over yet. It's your turn to go to work. We're going to have these dialogue circles. I'm going to name them again for you. The first one, looking at Canada's opportunities for leadership when it comes to environment and climate change. It will be led by Deborah Harford with SFU's Adaptation to Climate Change team and Betsy Agar with Renewable Cities. That's going to be held in the lobby downstairs. In the upstairs lobby, the second session will focus on international relations and security, led by Nicole Jackson from SFU's School for International Studies and Catherine Sheps with Renewable Cities. And then also upstairs, we'll be talking about international development and human rights. This will be led by Renee Black, Executive Director of Peace Geeks, and Sebastian Merz with SFU Center for Dialogue's Civic Engage program. And I just want to now invite Robert Weston to do some final closing remarks.
Good evening, everyone, and hello to all of those watching online. Well, that truly is quality dialogue. Thank you very much, Laura. You've been truly spectacular this evening, and it's been a real treat to have had the opportunity to have you here with us this evening. It also gives me great pleasure to thank Sheila, Roland, Shuvaloy, and Senator Yuen for sharing their perspectives to inform an evening of such rich dialogue. Please join me in another round of applause. As president of the Simon Fraser University's Alumni Association, I'm proud to represent our global community of nearly 150,000 alumni located across the globe, some of whom I'm sure are in the audience. The SFU Alumni Association has invested as a sponsor of this year's SFU Public Square Summit for the very reason that is so evident here tonight. The need to raise awareness of critical issues, expose new ideas, and to support the provision of intellectually engaging content that informs perspective for all. We hope that you leave this evening feeling more informed, perhaps with a new perspective, and that you will have had some time to develop a sense of real pride for the role that Canada takes in the world. You're reminded that there are still tickets available for a couple of the 2017 Community Summit events, so please visit SFU Public Square's website to find out more. For the alumni in the audience tonight, we also hope you feel proud of your connection to SFU, and we thank you for reconnecting with us in this capacity, and know that we'll be continuing to promote opportunities such as this to maintain your intellectual engagement with Canada's most community-engaged university. Thank you all for coming this evening, and please enjoy the rest of your evening. Thank you.